So yesterday we were trying to understand the whole context in which leadership, management, and various other issues which you're supposed to discuss in these 5 days interaction were situated. The background has to be very clear, has to be discussed, and then alone issues can be understood properly. And we have also seen that India is one of the major thought leaders of the world today, whether we recognize it or not. The world is looking to India. There are four major leaders in the world today, civilizations. One is India, obviously. Next is China. We all know that China is playing a big role in the world today. And United States of America, we obviously, it doesn't have to be mentioned, everybody knows that, United States of America. And fourthly, the Europe, United Union of Europe, European Union. So these are the four major civilizational players in the world. They are the thought leaders. As they say that Europe has old money, they can flaunt it around. America has new money, green dollar, new money. They can play with that. India has the brain power, mathematical genius, brain power. And we are moving to a knowledge society. So India has a distinct advantage, competitive advantage in this new world, emerging world. And China, of course, has the muscle power. You cannot ignore muscle power. Mere brain power is not enough. So these are the four major players in the world today in determining the new world order or in imagining the new world order. How should the world look like after 50 years? Let's say in 2050 or 60, how should the world look like? And everybody is trying to imagine that world. And whoever can imagine it most pragmatically, scientifically, he will lead the world. And the new emerging world will have not only material dimension, it will have an ethical and environmental dimension. All your actions and its consequences, its intentions, and the methods that you adopt will always be analyzed and assessed and critiqued in terms of its environmental impact. You cannot escape from that. So to its ethical impact, how does it affect other people, the marginalized people, the poor people, the sick people, the old people? And soon than later, the number of old people are going to overtake the number of young people. Japan has already achieved that miracle. There are more old people than young people. Europe is slowly moving toward that. India is still considered the young country. The majority are young people here. And America also is slowly becoming old. So the old age, how do you take care of the old people? Of course, Indian culture has a tradition of taking care of old people. We have an ashrama called Vanaprastha and Sannyas. And in Vanaprastha and Sannyasa, Vanaprastha is after 55 or 60 years of age, and after 75, Sannyasa. So we have something, preparedness. Our culture prepares people in tackling with old age problems, old age finance. So these are some of the issues which will gain importance. Environmental issues, ethical issues, and then there is spiritual issues. After all, with all this material prosperity for which we all are working, the final question is that, are you happy? And if you ask him, oh, I have everything, money sitting in the bank, all kind of gadgets, all kind of comforts, and still the question hangs fire, are you happy? Is, what's the problem? In spite of all this, why are you not happy? This is a spiritual question. Why we are not happy? Why are we not content? What's lacking? Why there is some emptiness in life? How do you fill it up? And the West is facing that issue now. A kind of general emptiness, purposelessness, meaninglessness in life. They don't have to work. For example, in Europe, they work only for 35 hours a week, not a day. Day doesn't have 35 hours anyway. So they work only 35 hours a week. And they have extended holidays, 3 months holidays, all paid by the company or by the government. And maternity leave, 6 months. Now they give maternity leave for father roles, husband roles. Husband also can take leave. If you want leave, the wife is pregnant, husband also can take leave. So those kind of, all kind of conveniences are there. Still people are bored, bored to death. It is such a paradox. We have been, for the last 500 years, we have been pursuing the chimera, the El Dorado, the heaven of material prosperity. And having pursued this heaven of material prosperity, are we inwardly happy? That question still is remained unanswered. And hence, I would say spirituality will be a major issue in the new world. How can you make people happy? In Bhutan, instead of GDP, gross domestic product, they're talking about gross happiness product, GHP. How can you make people happy? In Britain, the new conservative leader, Cameron, he's talking about gross well-being of the society. How can you enhance the well-being of people? And these issues we have been debating since time immemorial. For example, in Kaupina Panchaka. Kaupina Panchaka is a 5 verses written by Adi Shankaracharya. He says, Kaubi Navanda Kalubhagyavanta. This person sitting under a tree wearing only a kaupina, the minimum dress, and eating from his hands because he doesn't have any vessel. He owns nothing. He's sitting under a tree. He is not draped in costly costumes. He has nothing. Nobody. Sitting under the tree, and he is very happy. He doesn't even have a shirt. He is a very happy person. What is the secret of happiness? So spiritual, that's a spiritual question. Because materially, you cannot answer that question. Even morally, you cannot answer that question. You may lead a very moral life, very principled life. Still, you can be an unhappy person. You can say, I have been leading a very principled life for of what use? Nobody recognizes me. Nobody appreciates me. No Nobel Prize for me. Everybody is getting Nobel Prize. So this way, a person who may be principled, ethical, and still he can remain unhappy. So it seems that happiness is a different cup of tea, and people are not able to achieve that true happiness. So that is the spiritual question which you are wrestling with, and it is for that the West is coming to us. They want to practice yoga, they want to meditate, they want to live a simple life. They want to reduce their needs. And when you reduce your need, then the mind is quiet, there is more space in the mind. Then we are able to invoke the spirit. So these kind of ideas, which we have been discussing in our wisdom tradition, is becoming popular in the world today. So what I was saying is, in imagining the new world, we will have to take into consideration the both material, moral and ethical, and spiritual dimensions of human existence. Without that, success have no meaning. As somebody said, success is when you get what you want. Whatever you want, you get it. By hook or crook, means fair or foul, doesn't matter. You got what you want and the whole world hails you as the most successful person. But that doesn't guarantee happiness. Happiness is when you want what you get. Whatever you have, you love it. You live with it. You are happy with it. So happiness is a choice that you make. Happiness is not harvested from the world of sensations. Happiness is a fundamental choice that you make that, that I am going to be happy. It's your choice. Nobody can deny it from you. Even if you are in a jail, within the boundary of stone walls, without even a window, the outer world, you can be happy. You may be outside, possessing the whole world, still you can be unhappy. So these are some of the issues which we have to discuss in a very deeper way. And India can play a big role in that. It is in this context that we are discussing goal setting and team building. And we are trying to understand it from the standpoint of the yajna. Yesterday, I left you there. I gave you just an idea of the yajna. What does it all mean? Now, I've talked about ancient days in the Vedas. We all are Vaidikas. Vaidikas means whose fundamental faith is drawn from the Vedic principles. The Vedas have many wonderful principles. One principle is Egam Sat Vipraha Bahudha Vadanti. Truth is one, but people describe it differently. So you can have different ideas, different interpretations, different way of experiencing truth. It's not only just one way, or all the way to the highway. It is all many ways. It's like a diamond. Truth is like a diamond. The more faces it have, the more shine it will have. So that's how the Vedic rishis understood truth. Egam Sat, truth is one. Vipraha Bahudha Vadandi. And then another interesting thing in the Veda is, it begins with Vedahametam Purisham Mahantam Aditya Varnam Tamasaparastad. We came to know the truth. It begins with that declaration. By the end of the Veda, it says, Ko Veda, who knows the truth? So it comes with the more you know, the more humble you become. The more simple you become. The more open-minded you become. So at the end in Nasadiya Sutta, the Veda says, Nasadasi, Sadasi, Tadanim. There was neither naught or aught at that time. Neither darkness nor light at that time. Neither life or death at that time. Neither gods or creation at that time. Who knows what is ultimate truth? With that question mark, the Veda end. That is the final sloga of the Veda. So I would call it Veda leaves you with a spirit of inquiry. You have something more to do. It is not a closed chapter, it's not the last book. Thereafter, no other book, no other revelation, no other prophet, no other truth, explanation of truth. We all have the freedom to inquire into the truth. And then we have, Anu Bhadra Kradavo Yandu Vishudaha. Let noble thoughts come from all sides. Let us not shut our windows and doors. Let thoughts come from all sides. That also is the declaration of the Veda. The Veda also talks about that the world is an expression of God. Purusha Sukta in the Veda. Sahasra Shirsha Purushaha, Sahasraksha Sahasrapat, Sabhumim Vishudo Vritva, Atyatishtad Dashangulam. So the whole world is seen as the limbs of God, as the body, Vabus of God. So this world also is divine. Purnamada, Purnamidam. That is divine. This also is divine. This is a unique way of understanding the world by the Vedic civilization. The world is divine. The tree is divine. This mountain is divine. The river is divine. The sun and star and the moon, everything is divine. Even your enemy is as divine or undivine as you are. If you are divine, indeed, your enemy also is divine. The same spark which animates you animates the other person. We are playing different roles on the world stage. That kind of an understanding is given in the Vedas. It is this awareness that the world is looking for, which Mahatma Gandhi lived, which Rabindranath Tagore lived, which Maharishi Aurobindo lived, which we all are trying to live. And that's what the world is looking for now. Now, when we set the goals for whether a national goal or a industrial goal or an organizational goal, whichever area you are operating, and we all are operating on different levels. You are a citizen of this country, you are a world citizen, you are a professional, you are a father. So depending upon the roles you play, you have different goals. So whichever level you are operating, human beings have to set goals. Otherwise, you cannot work. Which is very beautifully said in the Bhagavad Gita. Nahi kachishanam abhijadu tishtatya karma grudha. Karyade yavashak karma sarvehi prakrutijehi gunehi. We all are bound by action. We cannot avoid activity. Because central teaching of Bhagavad Gita. Some people say, I want to give up everything and sit quiet. And you try to do that. You give up everything, you leave home, you leave your family, your duties without telling anybody, you go to the ashram. And when you reach there, you find in ashram there is more work than at home. At home, at least you will get cups of tea, newspaper, and you can ask and scold people, do this, do that, and because you are the boss of the house. But in ashram, you have to live like a student. You have to get up at 4 o'clock. You have to do pranayama, meditation, clean the ashram utensils and kitchen and cook and serve and then be very nice also. Chant mantras for long hours, study the scriptures, which is very difficult. And finally you decide, in ashram there is more work than at home. Therefore, you send a telegram to your family. People, I'm sorry. I took a wrong decision, made a wrong choice in coming to the ashram. I am coming back. And they will immediately write you back, don't do that. We stay there. You are pursuing the highest goal in life. And that is possible only in the ashram. Don't make a mistake again. You say you made one mistake. Don't make another mistake. Stay back. Now you are in real Trishangu Sarga. Whether I should be in the ashram or at home. So wherever you are, whether you are in a multinational company, whether you are in ashram, or whether you are all on the road as a beggar, as an avadhood has got more work because he has to walk all the way. And he does not know where the next meal. And he has to deal with all the stray dogs on the road. It's not an easy vocation or profession to be an avadhood. So wherever you are, Krishna says, you cannot avoid work. And even sitting quiet itself is a work. And it requires a lot of energy. You will know that. I ask you to sit quiet for 10 minutes. At the end of it, you say, Swamiji, let me lie down for 5 minutes. Why, what happened? Oh, I am so exhausted, so tired. It requires a long discipline to sit quiet even for 5 minutes. And hence Bhagavan says, human beings are condemned to work. And those people who think it is a burden, it's a burden. Those people think it's an opportunity to explore and express my infinite potentialities. Work become an opportunity for them. It all depends upon how you look at work. So it is through work. Work means to interacting with the world, receiving sensation, responding to sensations. When you engage in this interactive process, which is called work. And for work, you need certain goals. Without goal, nobody can work. For any work, there should be a directed activity, is called work. And goal means you want to create certain outcomes, which is the purpose of work. And if the outcome is not created, you will continue to work till you create that outcome. Then you set another goal. And human beings are programmed like this. Now Krishna says, so nahi kashishanam abhijatu tishtatya karma grudha, karyade yavashak karma sarvehi pragrujehi gunehi. But now the problem is when we work, we tend to get tense. Because you have no control over the outcome of our work. Since you have no control over the outcome, you can work as Krishna says, karmanne vadhigaraste, mabhaleshu kadajana. Since you have no control over the outcome of the work, it creates tension. Will I get the desired outcome? Will I get the desired result? If I don't get, will I not be wasting all my resources and money? This question creates tension. And therefore, Krishna's advice is, yajnarthat karmanonyatra. May your work become a yajna, a sacrifice. This is what I will be exploring, this idea. Yajnarthat karmanonyatra. So work need not be a cause of tension. Work can be a means of self-expression. How else will you express yourself? It's only when you take a shoemaker, a cobbler. He takes a piece of leather, looks at the piece of leather, cuts corners, folds it, stitches it, and finally he makes a beautiful pair of shoes. And when he does that, he's expressing himself. There's no other way of self-expression. Or a person, a sculptor, he picks up a piece of stone, and he again knocks off the corners of the stone, and finally brings out a beautiful idol, a Krishna, out of that stone. He's expressing himself. So through work, you can express who you are. There's no other way of expressing who you are. By merely saying is not enough. Anybody can say anything. Your CV, your biodata put out in the internet may say a lot of things. The articles you have written, the articles you intend to write, the article wanted to write but failed to write, the article you wished you should have written, all those things you write. But people know that these are all symbol air, symbol wish list. There's nothing truly concrete behind it. But when you work and produce result, you understand who you are, and others also understand who you are. So work one cannot avoid. But at this point, work creates tension, agitation, and all kind of health issues. So how can you convert work into a joyous, enjoyable experience? That's what we are going to explore today. So yesterday I talked about the idea of a yajna. In a yajna, the most important thing is the yajna shala. A yajna shala where you select a place at the right location, and having selected the place, then you put 16 posts all around this place and make it a holy place. By putting this post at 16 corners, you make it a holy place. That is called a yajna shala. Outside it is wild, inside it is sacred. Outside the yajna shala it is profane. Inside the yajna shala, it is sacred. You are going to do something sacred now. So first is preparing the yajna shala. And the second is, after preparing the yajna shala, but before you prepare the yajna shala, there is another thing. There is a yajamana, a person who plans and finances the yajna. The yajamana decides. He may be a king, he may be a rich man in the community. He decides that I must perform a yajna. I have enough resources to perform the yajna. And the yajna could be for personal benefit, like putra, vitta, or cows, for personal benefit, or surga. The yajamana may think of a yajna, or for consolidating his kingdom. A king may engage in a yajna, an ashwamedha yajna, expanding the territory of the kingdom. One of the instructions by Chanakya for a king is, the king has to keep expanding his territory. If he doesn't engage in the expansion of territory, like political parties, BJP is trying to come to power in all states, isn't it? That is legitimate for a political party. Congress is trying, on the contrary, to come to dislodge the BJP and come to power in all states. And if possible, have an alliance with the neighboring states also, with Sri Lanka, with Burma, with Pakistan, if possible, which seems to be an impossible task, but they are trying. So with all these neighboring countries, they want to create a common economic space. So any king or government will, it is within their legitimate rights to expand their territory. Chanakya uses the word vijigishu. A king has to be a vijigishu, constantly trying to expand his territory. A businessman also has to be a vijigishu, constantly trying to expand his market share, constantly trying to increase the sale of his products, constantly trying to build his brand equity or brand. This is his, what he is trying to do. A king or a businessman cannot sit and say that, I am, it's okay for me, this is enough for me. And when you say like that, when you sit idle like that, you will not be able to survive. To survive, you must keep moving, keep growing. Life means to keep growing. When you stop growing, then you are dead. So whether you are a king or a businessman or a teacher has to expand his territory, more students for the teacher. Teacher cannot say, I am happy with the 2 students or no student. Even if nobody, I'll keep preaching. That doesn't make any sense. So these are all allowed to expand. So king has performed yajnas to expand his territory. A businessman performs yajnas to expand his wealth. And a teacher performs yajnas to expand his mind, his consciousness. These people all are allowed to perform yajnas. So first you make a sankalpa. Let me perform a yajna for such and such purposes. Thus you set the goal in life. And a person who does that is called an entrepreneur. In the modern management lingua, is called an entrepreneur. And the ancient yajna language is called a yachamana. A yachamana. Yach means to sacrifice, yachamana. So whether you call him an yachamana or a karta, say karta, a yachamana, or a sreshta, the third word used is a sreshta, the leader of the community. He decides, let me perform this yajna. So he created a sankalpa. And when the sankalpa comes to his mind, and he developed that sankalpa, now he has to organize resources. The first is the sankalpa. The problem with us Indians, most of the time, we are not able to arrive at a common sankalpa. What is our vision for the nation? What is our vision for the company? What is our vision for the state? We are not able to command a vision and command a sankalpa. At whatever level it may be, it can be just on the organizational corporate level or a national level, or the panchayat level, or the family level, or the personal level, you must command a vision for yourself. Then alone, you'll have a mission. Mission means a drive and energy to pursue that sankalpa. So in the yajna culture, the first thing is the sankalpa, and after making the sankalpa, and then the yajamana, for every yajna, yajamana and patni together perform the yajna. An unmarried person is not allowed to perform yajnas. That's why when Rama, or without a wife, you cannot perform a yajna. When Rama wanted to do the Ashwamedha, at the end of the Ramayana, he has already banished Sita to the forest. The priest told, you may perform the Ashwamedha, but where is your dharma patni? So Rama did not have Dharmapatni beside him. So he has to make a golden statue of Sita and place her beside him. And then alone Rama was allowed to perform, because the wife controls the emotions of the man. Man may have wild emotions and he may perform yajnas with ulterior motives. But if you have family and children, then they will control your, sober your emotion. So only a married man was allowed. Whether you are a king or a brahmana or a kshatriya or a vaishya, only married people are allowed to perform the yajnas. So the sankalpa is made, and generally the sankalpa, like Rama performed, Dasharatha performed a yajna. What was the purpose of Dasharatha performing the yajna? The yajna is called putra kameshti. Putra kameshti for putra kama, desire for putra. Because he married three times, Dasharatha was a very powerful king, but he is unhappy because he did not have children, no heir to the kingdom. Therefore, Dasharatha wanted children, and then seek the advice of the rishis. The rishis said, okay, you perform this particular yajna, putra kameshti. And Dasharatha performed putra kameshti, and he got four children as a result of that. So, putra artham, you may perform yajna. Or rajya artham, to expand the kingdom, dharmaputra performed the rajasuja yajna. And through the rajasuja yajna, he expanded the kingdom. Or somebody else performs the yajna for increasing the herd, the cows he has. A farmer or a vaishya performs yajna for increasing the herd, the cows, number of cows in his possession. And somebody else, a Brahmin, may perform a yajna for gaining heaven. I'll be coming to all this, who is a Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, and all that, in my talks on the Guna theory and motivation and communication. For the time being, let us understand different people perform yajna with the different motives and purposes. So, the sankalpa is made, and now he has to organize the workers. And who are the main people who perform the yajna? Yajamana can only bankroll the yajna. But there are people who will actually perform the yajna. And the people who perform the yajna are called the ritviks. There are four ritviks: Udgada, Hoda, Adhuryu, and Brahma. Four ritviks are called. Actually, there are 16 ritviks divided into four categories. And these four categories are Udgada, Brahma, Hoda, and Adhuryu. Adhuryu is the one who prepares the material for the yajna. Udgada is the one who chants all the mantras for the yajna. And Hoda is the one who actually performs the sacrifices into the fire. He knows what material is to be offered at which part of the fire. It is a very elaborate technology. Fire sacrifice is a very elaborate technology. They say the fire has got seven different flames. As the fire is alive, and the yajna kund is alive with the fire has got seven flames. These seven flames are named Kali, Karali, Chamano, Javacha, Sulohida, Yacha, Sudhumravarna, Spulinkini, Visharuji, Chadevi, Lela, Yamana, Idi Sapta Jikwa. The material are to be offered to the appropriate fire. So that, why are you offering this material into the, or dravya into fire? Through offering dravya into fire, you are seeking to propitiate different gods, devadas. Devada prityartham vayamidam karishe, to propitiate gods. So what is the parallel of gods in the yajna into the modern business world? What is the parallel? Devadas, who is the devada in business or in politics? When a businessman, every day he worships, he says his prayers, whom is he trying to propitiate? Or a politician, he worships, whom is he trying to propitiate? Whose blessing he is seeking? I choose a businessman, for him, customer is king. Customer is God. A businessman is trying to seek the blessings of the customer, because customer is God for him. Or a politician is trying to seek the blessings of the people, the voters. If you have a vote, the politician will touch your feet. And if you have the purchasing power, the businessman will touch his feet. So businessman is trying to propitiate a customer who has got purchasing power. A politician is trying to propitiate a citizen who has got a voting power. If he comes to know you have no vote, he is not going to look at you. So in the yajna, we are trying to propitiate gods. In the modern context, what is meant is, we are trying to seek blessings of the customer or the voter or the people. People are God in this country. You can say the nation is my God. Some people make nation as the God. Some people make something else as God. But whatever God you have in mind, through your activity, you are trying to seek the blessings of that God. So friends, let us imagine it once again. In a yajna means yajnashala, priest, fire. Without a fire, there is no yajna. And what's the parallel for fire in the modern world? The fire is energy. Without energy, physical energy, oil or whatever, natural resources, and also the human resource, the human energy, without that, you cannot achieve anything. So the fire is very important in the yajnashala. Mantras are very important in the yajnashala, because all the dravyas you offer are offered along with the mantras. And mantra, I would call, is technology. In the modern world, technology is the mantra. Without technology, human labor has no value. Why America is so productive? Why India is not that productive? Our agricultural productivity is very low. Whereas America, 3% of the population produce wheat and grain for the whole world. The whole world can be fed by American farmers if they want. Why? Because they enhance their productivity by the use of technology. Every individual's productivity is enhanced by technology. Our farmers are not using technology, and hence their productivity is low. So in the Mantra Shastra, in the Yajna Shastra, what they say is, every dravya that you offer into fire, its power, potency is enhanced by chanting of mantras. Similarly, every effort you make, the potential of that effort will be enhanced by a technology. So use of technology is very, very important. These days people say technology is not necessary. Mahatma Gandhi said that. Mahatma Gandhi was not for technology. When Mahatma Gandhi said, there was a particular reason for that. At that time, technology was an instrument of suppression and oppression and exploitation by the powers that be. Now we are our own masters, so we don't have to be afraid of technology. Technology can be used for our own empowerment and for our own progress. So look at that yajna metaphor in a very deeper way. In the yajna metaphor, you have all these items. There are about 10 constituent factors in a yajna. Let me enlist that for your sake. First is the yajnashala, then the fire, then the rituks, then the mantras, then the dravya that you offer into the yajnashala. Just imagine a yajnashala. Here is a pandal, and there are various points where the pillars are installed, and within that territory is a holy place, and then there is fire, and the priests are sitting around. There are 4 priests, and the yajamana and patni on one side, and the priests are chanting mantras and offering the dravyas into the fire, and they are propitiating gods. And how many gods they propitiate? There are many gods said in the Vedas: Indra, Rudra, Varuna, Maruta, etc. Indra is propitiated for rain, Rudra is propitiated for power, Marud is propitiated for natural resources. So different gods are propitiated for different purposes. And then, after the yajna, then the yajna shishta, whatever comes as a result of the yajna, that is shared among everybody. And the yajamana takes whatever remains, which is called yajna shishta. I think it's a very powerful suggestion there. Yajamana takes only the yajna shishta. Similarly, in a company or in any entrepreneurial activity, the entrepreneur gets the yajna shishta. He has to provide for all the stakeholders, and whatever balance remains, the entrepreneur takes. This concept of yajna is very, very powerful, which can be employed in the modern world. Whether you are running a country, or you are running a corporation, or a NGO, whatever organization you run, the concept of yajna can be employed. That's what I said. Yajna model will be very, very powerful for running modern organization. And the key concept in yajna is tyajyam. The meaning of yajna is yaj tyajane. Yaj means to sacrifice. And when you sacrifice, whatever you sacrifice, it comes back to you. Because the whole world is based on sacrifice. A river sacrifices itself into the ocean. And the ocean gives back to the river. Is it not? All the rivers finally join the ocean. And the ocean waters are heated up by the sun, become vapor, become clouds, and in turn become a river. So this cycle of energy, by giving you are receiving. When the river is giving to the ocean gives back to the river. Thus you create a flow of energy. A flow of energy. And in that flow of energy, so much is happening. If the river does not join the ocean, and the ocean doesn't give back to the river, then there is no flow of energy. So yajna means to create this flow of energy, to give and then receive. Look at in nature, we breathe out. What we breathe out, the carbon molecules, which is breathed in by the trees, what is given out by the tree is received by us. So there is a cycle we see of giving and receiving. And in a river and ocean cycle we see, giving and receiving. Parents sacrifice for the children, and children in turn sacrifice for parents. You may doubt that statement. Parents are sacrificing for children. Where is children sacrificing for the parent? Really, they are giving you back. They may not be giving you back directly. All your pension fund, which you invested, the money that you invested has no value unless the new generation works hard. So the new generation is working and giving you back. So the parents sacrifice for the children, children sacrifice for the parents. The sun and the moon is sacrificing for us. The whole nature is built on the principle of sacrifice. That's why our Rishi said, life is based on a sacrifice. And yajna means yaj, tejane, or yachane, to sacrifice, to give. A farmer sacrifices the seeds, broadcast the seed. Suppose a farmer keeps the seed in a plastic bag and buries in his under his bed. What will happen to that? The seed will go waste. But if the farmer plows the land, broadcasts the seed, after an year or so, he will get a rich harvest, bountiful harvest. So the principle is give and receive. And hence, that is how you create prosperity. A businessman, he makes money, he invests the money, and he takes money back. Don't blame him. He is performing a yajna. By investing his money and taking his money back, maybe in thousandfold, he is performing a yajna. You pay the tax to the government, and in turn the government gives you back in in terms of roads, education, health, and various other welfare measures. You give to the government, government gives you back. Similarly, so the whole idea of give and take is very spiritually organized in a yajnashala. You are giving to gods. Where are those gods? They are imaginary powers. They are described in the Vedas. So you give to the gods clarified butter, various other dravyas, you give to gods. You sacrifice an animal and give to gods. You sacrifice mantras, you offer mantras, give to God. So in any area of human activity, you find this principle of giving and taking works. And that's the basis of yajna. By that you create a flow, affluare. Affluence means to create this flow. If you keep it with you, whatever you possess, whatever you retain will perish in your hands. Whatever you give will come back to you. If you help a poor man sometime in your life, that poor man will remember you. There are so many stories you must have experienced in your life. You helped a man on the way, you forget about it. Then you are waiting for in the bus stand, and it's difficult for you to walk because you are old. Then suddenly a young man comes. Do you remember me? You are the one who helped me. I will help you. Get into my car. You don't have to get into the bus. And at that time, you remember, the little help you done at that time has come back to you. So by giving, you are receiving. That is the principle of yajna. Thus you create an atmosphere of prosperity and trust, which requires trust. Some of the economists say, India is a low trust society. We may trust our neighbors, but we don't trust with our money with anybody. I was a low trust society. If I give you money, it will never come back. If I give you my house on rent, you will never vacate. So therefore, there are so many houses in this country lying vacant, where our people are living on the street. And what a low level of economic activity. There are houses here, there are people who want a house, but the twain shall never meet because of lack of trust. But in a yajna, we have to cultivate trust. First give, and then trust that it will come back. And hence, the Bhagavad Gita says, Saha yajna praja srishtva puro vajah prajapadihi anena prasavishyadvam esha vaha astu ishtakamatuk. God has created man with this ability to trust the other, with this ability to give and receive. Saha yajna praja srishtva. Man has been created like that. We have that capability, but somehow or other we have not activated that sensibility. Education means to activate that sensibility of yajna, to trust with your neighbor, to trust with the nature, to trust with the other. And in that trust, you are creating affluence. They say in heaven and hell, both heaven and hell are very prosperous places, they say. Both are prosperous. But the difference is, people in hell are suffering and people in heaven are enjoying. In heaven and hell, there is one problem. The problem is you cannot bend your hand. That is the only problem. Everything else is okay. You cannot bend your hand. It's good. Because by bending the hand, you become so selfish. Whatever you take goes to the pocket, isn't it? Doesn't go to anybody else. So God had decided in hell and heaven at least that nobody can bend their hand. Nobody can become selfish. Now, both people in heaven and hell, hell also there are plenty of good things. Heaven also plenty of food. Hell also plenty of food. Hellish people in hell are going starving. They are not able to eat because they cannot take food and put it in their mouth. They are all looking at each other, not knowing what to do. But in heaven, the beauty is that he takes the food and puts it in his neighbor's mouth. You eat it. And the neighbor takes food and puts it into the other person's mouth. So they mutually nourish and cherish. By the mutual nourishing and cherishing, you are enhancing the total affluence of the community. And hence Krishna says, Saha yajna praja srishtva puro vaja prajapadihi. In the very beginning God said, Anena prasavishyuddham, may you prosper by the spirit of yajna, by giving and receiving. Our problem is, we receive, we are happy to receive, but we forget to give. And hence Krishna says, first you give, then you will receive. But what guarantee is there? We don't have the trust. Since we don't have trust in people, our houses are lying idle, our factories are lying idle, our products are lying idle, because there is a general lack of trust Nobody trusts anybody in this country. In other countries I have seen, like developing countries, a word is enough. If you say, I will deliver, and it will be delivered. Here if you say, ho jayega, and the meaning is, it will never happen. Ho jayega. And then you say, it's okay, ho jayega. You go to a government office, with the fate of the file that you want some permission. The government officer will be all smiles and all that, ho jayega. You have to go and come back hundreds of times, and then you discover the file has not yet arrived from the lower division clerk. So why didn't you tell me before? Why didn't you tell you before? What do you mean? Then the officer gets angry. Then you don't know what to do. Because you are the mercy of that person. And that person has got power over you. Actually, he's supposed to be a servant of you. He's a public servant. Public means you and I. He's a public servant. But he uses his power so autocratically. He uses the no, the power of no, for an officer. Officer should always say the word yes. He did never, ever use of the word. No is such a powerful word, isn't it? That is how people exercise power over you. Your children. How do you exercise power over the children? By saying no. You will not allow the child to do whatever he wants to do. So here, what happens is, no trust. And partly it is true also. You go to the office with a certain request. You say, I need permission to do this. I am setting up a factory and I need electricity. Actually, you have not set up any factory. That electricity will be sold in the back market to somebody else. So therefore, there is a general atmosphere of distress in our country. Krishna says, Sahayajna prajasrishta purovaja prajapadihi anena prasavishyadvam. May you prosper by the performance of yajna. Work becomes a yajna. Work becomes a mutual caring and sharing and nurturing and nourishing. Anena prasavishyadvam esha vaha astu ishtakamaduka. And such a society, such a community become a kamadhenu. You must have heard the idea of Kamadhenu. Kamadhenu means a mythical cow who is capable of providing anything. All of your wishes will be fulfilled. You ask Kamadhenu, the famous story of Kamadhenu in the Ramayana. Yajnavalkya goes to Vasishta. Vishwamitra. Vishwamitra was the king, very powerful king. He goes to the forest hunting with a retinue of 10,000 army people, followers, and he meets Vasishta, the lonely rishi living in the middle of the forest. And Vasishta receives Yajnavalkya with all honor, please come. And take your, have a bath in the river and take your meals. So Vishwamitra said, I have 10,000 people with me and here you are alone. How are you going to provide for 10,000 people? That doesn't matter. You take the bath and come. So Vishwamitra goes with all his retinue, 10,000 people, take the bath and come back. By the time the food is ready, delicious 7-course meal is ready. And they ate a sumptuous meal. They were very happy. At the end of the day, Vishwamitra asked Vasishta, how did you manage this miracle? So Vasishta said, see that cow? That cow is Kamadhenu. Whatever I ask, she gives me. Now Vishwamitra said, oh, such a cow. What will you do with that cow? Give it to me. I am the king. See, greed. The problem is greed. You cannot tolerate anybody having anything which you don't have. So therefore, Vishwamitra said, I need that cow. And I am the king. I need the cow. And king is powerful. And when he becomes greedy, he takes to all kind of unjust means. He no more becomes the protector of poor people or good people. He becomes the exploiter of the poor and the good. Actually, the king's job is to protect the poor, the marginalized, the victims, and the good people. But when he become greedy, he forget all those norms. And Vishwamitra said, I need that cow. Vasishtha said, if you need that cow, okay, take it away. Because that is the dharma of a saint. Whatever you need, take it away. But when Vishwamitra went to the cow got angry and hit Vishwamitra. And Vishwamitra realized, it is not that easy to take away things from good people. And finally, you'll have to pay for that. And the story goes, and Vishwamitra could not take away the cow. So the thrust of the story is an ideal of a Kamadhenu or a Kalpavriksha, where all your wishes are fulfilled. And all your wishes can be fulfilled, provided you trust each other, you nourish each other, you cherish each other. It is by a cherishing and nourishing lifestyle, by giving and receiving, by giving and taking. First you give, then you take, that you can create an atmosphere of prosperity, plenty, and affluence. That's what happens in all developed countries, and that has to happen here. A high level of trust is important. There's a study by, I think it's by Francis Fukuyama, who wrote about the end of history and the last man. And he has written a book called The Trusting Society, Trust, the importance of trust between people. A trust means, I can trust you with my money, I can trust you with my property, I can trust you with my people, and you will not cheat me, you will not exploit me, you will be honoring all the deals, all the contracts, honoring the contracts. You don't have to go to the court and wait for 24 years to get your justice done. That kind of a trusting society is what Krishna envisages in the Yajnashala, through the spirit of Yajna. In Yajna, first you give to gods, then the gods give you back. In Yajna, first you give to the government, then the government gives you back. In Yajna, first you give to your children, then the children give you back. In Yajna, first you teach the people, and the people give you back. In Yajna, the farmer first gives the seed to the ground, and then the ground gives you back. This principle of giving and then receiving, it has to come back to you. Because your fear is what guarantee is there. It never comes back. I may give, but it never comes back. But the Yajna principle says, when you trust somebody, your trust will be reciprocated. The trust will not go unresponded. That kind of belief and culture is necessary. So, anena prasavishyadvam esha vaha astu ishtakamaduka. Devan bhavayadanena te deva bhavayanduvaha parasparam bhavayantaha shreyas paramavapsyada. And the trust should be on an ongoing activity. I trust you with whatever resource I have. You trust me and I trust you. And in the process, we are creating a culture of affluence, prosperity, productivity. Krishna uses all these words. Devan bhavayadanena ten deva bhavayanduvaha. You nourish gods, gods will nourish. Parasparam bhavayandaha shreyaf paramavapsyada. And by this mutual nourishing and cherishing, you create greater prosperity and a quality of life. Friends, though we had this yajna tradition in the past, we have forgotten that. We lost our trust in mutual. Trust is lost. We don't trust our government, do we? Very rarely we trust our government. We don't trust our neighbor. Very rarely we do that. And when a citizen lost trust in government, what is the quality of life in that country? When a citizen lost trust in their ministers, what's the quality of life in that country? When a customer loses trust in the businessman, what is the quality? And the businessman has no trust in you also. In the foreign countries I have seen, you buy a product and after a week you bring it back and say, I don't like it, they'll take it back. They'll take it back and take something in. Here, before you sell, it is written in a very small letters, one soul never taken back. that you don't write in a bold letter. If you write in bold letter, you may not buy it. It's in a very invisible small letter. One soul, never. And then they will turn the product or packet and say, didn't you read this? Not, you don't trust your customer. The customer never come back to you. This is our situation. I'm not saying we are that bad, but I'm saying that we can improve further. And somebody has to begin somewhere. That culture is to be created. In this country, we have to trust each other. Similarly, when a product, you order a book or something on the internet, or a computer on the internet, when it comes, you trust it. But sometime, instead of computer, you may get some mastics in the package. And when you go back and find out what is the matter, the company is already folded up. No trust. People are out there to cheat you left and right. And there is nobody to catch them. So therefore, we lose trust. So the yajna spirit is to be brought back. And the yajna spirit is mutual trust, mutual nourishing. I see my prosperity in your prosperity, and you see your prosperity in my prosperity. If I try to pull you down in the process, I myself will go down. When the water level goes up, all boats also will go up. So one has to trust each other. This is what Krishna says. And then having engaged in this productive activity, and when there is wealth is created, because all yajna is wealth creation. That is the purpose of yajna. Creating wealth, cows, success in battle, or children, or comfortable living, or after death a place in heaven. When wealth is created, then the yajna tradition says you have to distribute the wealth. Dana is very important. Dana is an important, very important concept in our tradition. Whatever you have, a king performs a yajna, amasses a lot of wealth, extends his kingdom, like Kalidasa describes in Raghu Vamsha. Raghu extended his kingdom, amassed a lot of wealth. At the end of the day, what Raghu does is distributes all his wealth. And after distributing all the wealth, he wears only one piece of cloth, and he walks barefoot toward the Himalayas. On the way, he meets Kaudastha, a brahmachari. And the Kaudastha says, I need some money. And Raghu says, I have nothing to give you. But Kaudastha says, I am a brahmachari, I need some money. Raghu says, wait for some time. He again takes a weapon, goes to Kupera, and asks for some money. Give me a loan. Kubera says, I am ready to give you a loan, but how will you return it? You are not in power. You are barefoot on the road. So I have some doubts about your capacity to pay back, creditworthiness, because you don't have anything now. So I may have to charge a heavy fine. Then Raghu uses his Kshatriya prerogative. Okay, then I am going to fight with you. Let me fight with you. And if you ask a businessman that I'm going to fight with you with a gun on his temple, business, okay, take all the money, save my life. So Kubera said, all right, you can take the money. And Raghu brings that money, gives the Kaudastha, and send him back. Because when a brahmachari, a student comes to your house or approaches you and asks for a loan or a help, you are duty-bound as a grahastha to give. Education should be free. Or every individual, every child must have the right for education. That's our tradition. The government has to see to that. Every child gets education. That is part of yajna. It is his duty. So this kind of nourishing and cherishing is very important aspect of yajna. Thus you can create prosperity, says the Bhagavad Gita. So yajna shishta shina sandaha muchyande sarvagil bishay. So when the wealth is produced, you have to take care of all the stakeholders, not just the shareholders. Because American or European capitalism is built on nourishing only the shareholders. And there is certain logic in that too. But the yajna spirit is, take care of all the stakeholders. Of course, consumer is taken care of. He is given quality products at competitive prices. The government tax is paid. Environment is taken care of. Every stakeholder, every individual involved in the process is to be taken care of. And whatever balance remains, yajna shishtam, yajna shishta shina sandaha muchyande sarvagilbishi. Those who live by the yajna shishta, meaning the balance, the remnants of the yajna, he is muchyade, he is liberated. He is actually a free, a glorious leader. He is a glorious leader. He is the most successful person. He can make all the stakeholders happy and still make something for himself. He is the most successful person. Muchyande sarva kilbishehi. You will have no stress and strain in such activities. Whether you are in business or politics or NGO activities or family activities, wherever you are, you will be free from the tension of work by following the principle of yajna. Now, this ideal of yajna is to be brought up in a big way. People have to be educated like this. Trust is to be created. After all, business is a product of our culture. A certain culture is to be created for doing business and engaging in productive activities. The worker has to trust the management. The management has to trust the worker. The businessman, the producer must trust the consumer. The consumer has to trust the producer. And the science and technology people have to trust the business people. And business people have to trust science and technology. There should be total trust. Citizens should trust the government. Government should trust the citizens. Here nobody trusts anybody. And that is a very, very difficult, very problematic situation in our country. We have to bring the trust back. We have to bring the philosophy of give and take to create prosperity and plenty in this country. Now let me give you two models of yajna. One, the right model, and the wrong model of yajna. The right model of yajna is the churning of the ocean of milk. You must have heard that story. But I am trying to give you new meanings for that. The churning of the ocean of milk. Devas became very arrogant. Because in the Vedic world, there are devas, humans, and asuras. These are the three types of people in the Vedic universe. Those three types of people are even now existing. There is a deva dimension in your personality, isn't it? In our society. In our society, there are devas, good people. In our society, there are asuras, very bad people. In our society, there are humans, a mix of good and bad. Humans are a mix of good and bad. Asuras are completely bad. Well, who is a bad person? A bad person who enjoys in the sufferings of others. He is called a bad man. Who enjoys, who takes secret pleasure when you see the other man is suffering. The other man is sick. Secretly you think he deserves it. Though you call him by the phone and say, I'm very sorry to hear that you had a heart attack recently, inwardly what he thinks is, he deserves it. Isn't it? He is an evil person. You know, showing something outward and thinking something inward. And you come to know your house is on fire. Immediately pick up the phone. I am really sorry. I heard this bad news that your house is on fire. Inwardly, he is happy. So he is a bad person. And we all have that streak in our personality. There is an asura streak in our personality. There is a deva streak in our personality. Sometimes you can be extraordinarily good. A moment of extraordinary goodness. We all are capable of that. When we try to share our food, when we are very hungry and we see another hungry person, we share our food. In a moment of extraordinary goodness. But most often we are a combination of both good and bad. We are humans, both good and bad. Sometimes we are good, sometimes we are bad. We are operating in the gray areas, they say. Not in the extreme black and white areas. We operate in the gray areas. So devas, asura, these are arch type categories given in the Vedas. Devas, humans, and asuras. Deva, manava, and asura. And devas, they occupy heaven, asuras occupy the nether world, and human occupy the middle world here. And the exchange is always between devas and humans for prosperity. Asuras come and try to put hurdles. Their job is to always put hurdles in your path. Whenever we try to do something good, asuras come and try to create. Even now it is there. Somebody want to put up a factory there, a car manufacturing factory, and then there are a lot of obstacles for that. And finally, it has to be moved out. I am not telling you who is asura, who is there, it's for you to decide. Depending upon where your sympathies are, please don't get me wrong. Depending on where your sympathy, I am just putting the facts in front of you, it's for you to analyze. Depending on your sympathy, your perspective, your this, your that, accordingly you can decide. That is what you are trying to do here, trying to analyze things. And so that you all can take your own decision. My job is to not tell you what to do. My job is to tell you how to think. That's what I'm trying to do. My job is to bring you different perspective. So education means an ability to look at an issue from different perspectives. That's the meaning of education. And then make your choices. Informed choice. And if somebody else makes another choice, be comfortable with that too. That's his choice. That's not my choice. And I am happy it's choice. This is what education is all about. People may, West Bengal decided they don't need that car factory, that's their choice. Gujarat is always happy, isn't it? Come here. That is your choice. You need prosperity, they need politics. And generally they don't go together. Too much politics won't go together with prosperity. So you made your choice, they made their choice, and both are happy. They can keep on talking politics. You don't talk much politics, and your choices are different. So our job is to bring these different perspectives. So for prosperity, asuras, the devas and humans should interact. Deva is your potential. So you must explore your potential, interact with the deva. And asuras is your dark side. Whenever you try to lift yourself, there is always a pull backward. Like Hanuman was trying to jump into Sri Lanka, to find out Sita. He's a devotee of Rama. So he was flying, he was airborne. Then suddenly he found something is pulling him down. And when that pulls him down, Hanuman's nature is to fight with any obstacle. But then he thought, this is not for me to fight now. My goal is to reach there, not engage in these small mini battles. This is my own shadow pulling me down. Whenever you make an effort, your shadow side, your old fears, your old tensions, your old anxieties will pull you down, isn't it? You want to do something, immediately something in you tells you, you want to do it, you will never make it. That's your shadow side. So Hanuman somehow manages it. I'll talk about it later. So Hanuman manages his shadow and goes away. So deva is your aspiration, higher aspiration. Asura is your lower pulling back. Something is pulling you back. In this tension, the human life unfolds. Both are necessary. You cannot avoid them. So what you are, what you will be, all your destiny is determined by this tension between the devas and asuras in you. your bright side and your dark side. And most often the asuras win. You may give it any explanation, I am tired and I am exhausted, there is no point. So asuras win. Very rarely devas win. So whenever devas lose the battle, they go to the bigger god, Vishnu. Vishnu will give them some strategy, they win back things. See, then whenever you lose something, you go to the temple or gurus and, or a counselor or somebody and say, Guruji, explain to me, tell me what should I do. Or a counselor, he will tell you what to do, and you follow the advice, and you make it. Again, you make mistakes. So this is how life unfolds. So devas became very arrogant in their victory. Very arrogant. They couldn't care less for anything. They even forgot Vishnu. And once Durvasa gives a garland to Indra. Indra was riding his white elephant. Now he can afford all that. Earlier he was on the run. Now he is in power. Now he is riding the white elephant. So earlier whenever a problem comes, he used to run to these rishis and all that, gurus. But now he doesn't. Now guru has to come to him because he is in power. So Durvasa comes, offers a garland. Indra was on the Airavata and he took the garland, put it on elephant mastaka on the head because he couldn't care less. It's not a pole necklace or a diamond necklace or something. It's made up of wild flowers and leaves. Indra couldn't care less. So, and the elephant got disturbed because this wild flower attracted honeybees and the bees keep on humming. And the elephant felt hurt, disturbed, distracted. And he took the garland and trampled under his foot. And Durvasa came to know that. And he thought it's great arrogance. He cursed the Indras and the Devas. You all become old and decrepit and sick and become poor. This is what Durvasa cursed. Because the acme of prosperity. You become arrogant and you no more learn anything. You no more respect those people whom you respected, which brought you up to this stage. You become an ungrateful person and that will be the downfall of you. As they say, pride goeth before a fall. Now Indra became old, decrepit. Devadas became old and decrepit. Indra Loga became poor. And now asuras come and overwhelm them. Asuras, your negative aspect takes over, isn't it? It is at that time you become little cynical in life. Oh, I know all this. I have been there. You also can go there, but it's not such important. You become cynical, very sarcastic in life, very negative in life. Because you lose the momentum, you became arrogant. And that's what happened to devas, that happened to us. And the negative forces overpower you. And finally, devas start remembering Vishnu. Oh, we have forgotten Vishnu. Let us go back to him. Go to Vishnu, what should I do to revive, to rejuvenate, to reinvent, to recreate, to re-engineer ourselves. Have you heard all these phrases in management now? Re-engineering the corporation, reinventing new strategies, innovating, innovation, recreating ourselves, creating a great organization. Indra thought of reinventing, re-engineering himself. Vishnu said, that is possible, but you have to perform a yajna. And the time for yajna has come for India. Because we have to reinvent ourselves. We cannot continue with the old stuff anymore. It has given its mileage. The Vishnu said, it is time for you to perform a yajna. And in the yajna, you have to bring all stakeholders together. Asuras, devas, humans. animals, birds, reptiles, plants, everything must come together. It's a collective enterprise. Nobody should be excluded from this effort. Even Maoists start to be included. Why not? Even the communists start to be included. Everybody is to be included in this activity. So it should be a collective, creative, churning process. And you have to churn the ocean of milk. Milk represents our mind. Ocean of milk means our collective unconscious. Our collective mind is to be churned by a cooperative effort. So Vishnu said, Indra, go to Asuras. Give them a higher vision. At this point, they are chasing you for limited resources. Whatever limited thing is there, everybody is trying to share it, isn't it? The limited national cake is to be, want to be shared by everybody without contributing anything. Mayabadi wants, or Nidish Kumar wants, Jayalalitha wants, Mamata Banerjee wants, everybody wants. But are you contributing something to the national cake? You have to give them a higher vision. You have to sell them the serious consequences if you go this way. Just thinking of sharing, thinking of simple reservations. Reservation is not a bad idea, please don't get me wrong. But it has to be implemented properly. So now we are thinking of getting our share without contributing anything. Because people are not inspired. Nobody has the moral authority to demand sacrifice. Because nobody is doing that. Gandhi could do that. Subhas Bose could do that. Subhas Bose could say, give me your blood, sweat, and tears, and I shall give you freedom. He inspired us with a higher ideal. Gandhi could inspire us with a higher ideal. But can the present leaders do that? Can the present teachers could do that? So Vishnu says, give them a higher ideal, and then incorporate the help of everybody. So what is the higher ideal? The nectar, immortality. The nectar of immortality. That's the higher ideal. Tell everybody, Asuras, Devas, and Pannagas, Kinnaras, the snakes, the reptiles, the trees, mountains, everybody should participate. So Indra went around. So before that, Vishnu said, you have to get a churning road, a churning rope, isn't it? To churn, you need a rope. To churn, you need a rope, a road. And you also, the ocean is to be churned. So you go to Mount Manthara. Manthara is the right churning road. Go to Vasugi. Vasugi is the king of snakes. He will be the right churning rope. But the problem is, Vasugi is a good man, good thing. And he has got some idiosyncrasies. He may vomit in the middle. He may vomit. And the vomit is very poisonous. It's a snake. You have to use the snake, but at the same time, certain things have to be taken care of. It's like associating nuclear treaty with America. It's good to a certain extent, but you always should look for what is their interest in that, how are they trying to exploit you, how are they trying to make advantage of you. At the same time, you have your own advantage, you have to strategize your moves, and you have to give them something so that you can get them something. And it's all a give and take policy. And they have their own problem. They need support for whatever they say in the international fora. And if you don't support them, they create hurdles in your path. And they have military power to enforce their decisions on you. So therefore, be very careful. Similarly, Vishnu said this Vasugi is a very dangerous person. He will help you, but at the same time, he can create problems. And he can vomit poison. He can be very abusive sometimes. And you must stand all that. Therefore, don't stand on the head side. Devas advise your people not to stand on the head side. You must stand on the tail side. Indra said, but that is, we are Devas, we cannot stand on the tail side Okay? Then if you are that arrogant, stand on the head side and perish in the process. You have to make sure, swallow your arrogance and stand on the tail side. But the problem is, asuras may not agree with that. Asuras may like to be on the tail side. No, there is a solution for that. You go and tell the asuras, the king of asuras, that since you are lower than us, we devas are superior, you asuras are lower, therefore you should stand on the tail side and we will stand on the head side. That's all what you have to say. The rest will happen. Indra said, how does that logic work? Forget about it. Go and tell them this. If I explain to you, you will mess up the whole thing. You know, you may add new things when they give the clue, give them a clue, and then they will understand your strategy. So therefore, just go and tell them this. So Indra came to Asura Loka and had a discussion. Like Bush coming to New Delhi and having a discussion, then we going there. So Indra went there and said, see, this is the plan, this is a grand strategy, this is a grand vision, this is the mission that we have to follow, blah, blah, all that. And finally, we all have to work together, and I need your help. You must be on one side pulling the rope, and we can be on the other side. We can pull the rope and churn and all that. But there is only one condition. After all, we are superior people. So we will stand on the head side and you will stand on the tail side. When you said that, the Asura Raja said, nothing doing. If this has to take place, we have to be on the head side and you will be on the tail side. Mayavadi. We will be on the head side, you will be on the tail side. He said, it's very difficult. Then there is no deal. We will not have this. And the negotiation went on. Indra insisted they should be on the head side. Asuras insisted they should be on the head side. Finally, Indra, by Samadana Bheda Danda, you know, he pretended all that. He said, okay, I agree. You be on the head side. We will be on the tail side. Asuras, well, we won the negotiation. We incorporate this particular clause in the negotiation, that you should write it down in big letters, that asuras will be on the head side and we will be on the tail side. Write it on board letters and sign it and seal it. The asuras came on the head side, devas came on the right side, everything, the churning started, and all the trees, herbs from the world, they brought various herbs and poured into the ocean of milk. And the mantra became the churning road, and vasu became the churning rope, and asuras on this side, and devas on the other side, and humans to help things, and the churning started. So first principle is, have a higher vision, which can inspire everybody. All the stakeholders, all the parties have to be inspired. It should be a bilateral or trilateral or quadrilateral, whatever effort. It cannot be a partisan, unilateral effort. Wherever it has been tried, it has been a failure. You have to include everybody. It's an inclusive attempt. Now, the churning started, and take the best. And the process of churning, the mountain slipped. Now, it was a crisis. When the mountain slipped. The mountain stands for your willpower. And there is every possibility that you lose your willpower. You lose your grit and determination because there are obstacles and hurdles. Because human nature, the tamas, takes over. And when the willpower of the nation, the will of the nation sags and slips, then it is time for the leader to appear. Otherwise, Vishnu doesn't directly come into the picture. Vishnu only gives advices. Vishnu is a fantastic manager and leader. He simply lies down all the time. He is such a relaxed leader. Can you imagine he is leading the whole world, but he is very relaxed. He is something like Reagan in America once upon a time. Forgive me for giving these poor comparisons, but I have no other comparison. Reagan. Or like Narasimha Rao, very relaxed. He doesn't interfere much into things. It is said Narasimha Rao, while he was in office, never took any important, except one important decision. Of course, he took a very radical decision to turn the economy around, to liberalize and all that. Thereafter, he never did anything. So somebody asks, you hardly took any decision while you are in power, except the decision not to do anything, allowing people, business people to come, foreign investment to come. But government did nothing. He said, who said that I have not taken any decision? I have taken one decision, not to take any decisions. Because in India, how can you take decisions? Because you don't have the data. You don't have dependable data to take decisions. All your data is cooked up data. There is no real data. The agriculture department, the production, industrial department, the production, education department, the enrollment rate and this rate, that, everything is Babu sit in the office, cook up some stories. Nobody is on the field to get the real data. How many poor people are in India? Sometimes it is 37%, sometimes 25%, sometimes it is 50%, sometimes 75%. There's no proper data for anything. Narasimha Rao decided not to take any. That way he helped. Because when politicians are inactive, maybe business people can become active. Other civil society can become active when politicians are inactive. That is what saves India. So when the mantra slumbered and the will of the nation collapsed because of a lot of pressure, Vishnu wakes up. Vishnu comes in the form of a turtle, goes underneath and lifts the mountain and stabilizes on his back. This is the job of a leader. The job of the leader is when what others cannot do, he is ready to do. If somebody else can do that, he's like an emergency light. He goes off. When other lights are off, he comes alive. The leader is active only when others cannot perform a task. If others can perform, he sits quiet. That is the true leadership. He inspires others to do things. So generally you say management is getting others do your work. That is a very cynical definition of management. Really management is inspiring others to do the work, their work. Or the inspired work, inspiring others. So Vishnu comes and then. And then Vasugi, of course, vomits poison. And a whole lot of asuras died. And Shiva took the poison in his hand. Another leadership role. That when a grave crisis comes, the leader comes forward and swallows the poison. And when he swallows the poison, of course, Vishnu came and put his hand on Shiva's mouth. Parvati came and held his throat so that it will not go down. It goes down, Parvati suspects he may die. Vishnu think that the poison comes down, the world may be destroyed. The poison got stuck in the throat and it became a beauty spot around Shiva's neck. The leadership lesson is, the buck stops here. If something has gone wrong, I take the responsibility. If everything is gone all right, I share the benefit. I share the glory with everybody, and I take the responsibility for what has gone wrong. Another leadership lesson. Two important leadership lessons. How to strategize it, how to include everybody in the yajna, how to create a great vision, and how to be humble so that you go to everybody and explain the vision, how to make it possible. Because in India, the problem is, we are great planners, but we are poor, very poor implementers. We are not able to implement things. A lot of money is allotted, but nothing goes to the intended people. Only 10 paise goes of 1 rupee. The rest is all going into the pockets of various agencies, various bureaucrats. And hence, the yajna was successfully performed, and a lot of materials came out of that yajna. Diamonds, pearls, elephant, white elephant, flying horses, Lakshmi, moon, all these great bounties and beauties came out of this yajna. At the end of it, they created a very rich culture, a prosperous civilization. Devas were happy, asuras were happy, humans were happy, everybody is happy. Of course, asura had some problem. They always have problem, which I will deal with in some other situation. First, asuras ran away with the product. This is another problem. Not only you produce, you must protect it also. India was a great wealthy nation, but we couldn't protect our wealth. Our peacock throne was taken away by British or Iranians, or our wealth was taken away by foreigners. Ours was the richest nation in the world in the 17th century. Our GDP was 30% of the world GDP in 17th century, 16th century. But we couldn't protect it. So not only you produce, you must protect it. You make sure wealth remains under control of good people, which is very, very important. Wealth remains under control of good people. And when the Amrita was created, asuras ran away with it. Then Vishnu has to take another leadership role, go and somewhere or other get it back from them, and then keep under the control of. Maybe that's why America doesn't want Iran to have an atom bomb. Though we may think it is a very discriminative policy. Why, if America can have atom bomb, why not Iran? Why not India? Why not some other countries? The idea is that Iran is a rogue regime, period. We don't know what they will do with that bomb. Why we don't want a bomb with Pakistan? Because it's a rogue regime. We don't know what will they do with that. So wealth, not only you have to generate wealth, it has to be kept under the control of good people. That also is a very important thing. So Vishnu could achieve all this through the churning, the story of the churning of milky ocean. So I would like to read that story, the churning of milky ocean, and take as much information as possible from that. So too, there is another yajna called the Daksha Yaga. You must have heard about Daksha Yaga. Daksha did not follow any of this principle. He performed a yaga to glorify himself, no other higher goal. He wanted to teach a lesson to his son-in-law Shiva. The motivation was to teach somebody a lesson, Shiva. And you know what happened finally? Daksha lost his head. Not only he lost his head, he got the head of a goat. So whatever he has done for glorifying himself has come back to him in a different way. He lost the whole thing. So there is two yajna models. One is the churning of the Milky Ocean yajna model, inclusive activity. The other is the Daksha Yaga, where it is exclusive, arrogant, egoistic, and to promote self-promoting, and to teach somebody a lesson, revengeful. And as a result of that, that yajna was a failure and counterproductive. This yajna was a grand success. So in yajna, there are yajnas, different kind of yajnas. Some yajnas can help you if you perform the right way. Some yajnas can harm you if you are not following the rules. So friends, my idea was the yajna symbol or the yajna metaphor is very, very important. It's a center of Indian culture and tradition. It is that metaphor we have to bring in a big way in our nation building and developing our industries and playing our role in the community of nations. Let us bring back this tradition. And let us understand the idea that the Yajamana gets only Yajna Shishta, whatever balance remains, by giving and satisfying all the parties involved. So that is the Yajna culture, which we have to understand and teach our younger generation. And you can use those terminologies used in the Yajna tradition to revive our country and our culture. Now, tomorrow, I'll be talking about the Dharma model in conflict resolution. Conflict is a major issue these days. How do you resolve conflict? Conflict because everybody want their due in this world. Everybody want. I have my need, you have near your need, and resources are limited. When resources are limited and desires are unlimited, how do you negotiate these limitless desires and limited resources? How do you decide equitably in a just manner? So what is justice? What is equity? What is pragmatic in the whole process? This is what I will be discussing tomorrow's lecture. Conflict resolution, decision making, and in the process ensuring that everybody get their due. How do you make it possible? There was a time the strong decided what is to be done. That time is gone. I told you, war is no more a solution because we are living in a nuclear age. Nuclear age. War is no more a solution. Discussion, debate alone are solutions. So how do we apply the Dharma model in conflict resolution, decision making, will be theme of my talk tomorrow. And those who have questions about this, whatever talks I'm giving, those who have doubts and questions, please write it down and leave it here. And I'll be addressing those questions. Thank you very much. Tomorrow we'll meet again here, tomorrow at 6:30. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Okay. So tomorrow 8 o'clock is our...